دكتور رضا، وندعو للدكتور ابراهيم انه يقوم بالسلامه ان شاء الله هو اللي معاه. ودكتور رضا اتفضل ساعتك.
دكتور ده
بسم الله، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. ربنا افتح بيننا وبين قومنا بالحق وأنت خير الفاتحين. Dear colleagues, today is our sixth in series of TAVI. Today we have multiple stuff to present. our agenda today is to, last time we discussed about evolute R, today we are going to discuss about Sabian free valve. We are going to touch about the bicuspid aortic valve types of severe aortic stenosis. And we will mention some about the TAVI in patients with bicuspid aortic valve, how to choose the valve, step-by-step Sabian 3 case, valve-in-valve procedure, step-by-step another evolute R case, and to answer your questions, if any, getting another evolute R case, it's upon request because all my colleagues, they asked me to add some. Next plan for next week will be the TAVI complication and how to manage, but it is also, it can be changed upon your request. As we know that the startup of the TAVI business starts with the Edward valve when Alan Caribier, he could put the first in man, the valve. The Edward company is the company who started the this program, and they have a robust data, they have everything. When they started their valve, they started with stainless steel. This stainless steel to crimp it, to put it to the patient, it was very difficult, very large sheath, and then they have changed this stainless steel into a cobalt chromium. The cobalt chromium is stronger metal, it's more easier to be what we call compressed or crimped to a smaller size. The valve is formed of four rows of cells, if we can say it. The upper most one is the largest one, and for sure it's designed to facilitate coronary access. There is a commissural attachment here in this area, and it try to reduce the leaflet materials in this area. The struts angles are widened to allow the compression of this valve when it is compressed to be crimped to be loaded. So the design of these angles is by default is to try to reduce the size of the valve. And also this is almost is an open seal design that it can allow accessibility to the coronaries much easier. There is another three windows here that we call it the commissural windows. This is, it's a landmark of the commissures in the fluoro. It has a different shape and also it reduces the metal frame. The most important issue that it came in the Sabian 3 is the what we call it, the outer sealing skirt. This skirt is dedicated to be as a protection of, or as a treatment of the paravalvular leak. The Sabian 3 valve, it comes into four sizes, 20, 23, 26, 29. It's the new generation after the Sabian XT valve. The Sabian 3 even also now is replaced by the Sabian 3 Ultra, which is a new generation, the newest generation available in the market. The Sabian XT, it is still the one available in Egypt, but soon the Sabian 3 will be there. If I would like to focus just in both valves, there is something very important here, is that what we call the expanded and non-expanded. When the valve is crimped, the valve here is shorter as compared to the Sabian 3, and when it is expanded, it is very short. You can imagine that the 23 millimeter valve is only 14 millimeter. If you don't have an accurate angle, you see very well, you can easily miss the aortic root. the degree of foreshortened is almost double. It's a 3 millimeter in the Sabian XT, and it is markedly increased in the Sabian XT to be almost double plus. The delivery system starts with the Genius. Here it is color coded, and you can see here that 17 mil. It means that the 23 millimeter valve, if you inflate this one with 17 mil of volume, this valve exactly will be outer as 23 millimeter. If you increase the volume by 1 mil, you will increase half millimeter of the size of the valve. So if you inflate this one as 18 mil, so the valve will be 23.5 and so. Additional with the system, you will receive what we call, it's a type of Zimid balloon dedicated to the Edward. This is again, it's a volume driven balloon. This comes as 4 centimeter for all. It comes 20 millimeter with a 23 valve, 23 with a 26 valve, 25 for the 29 valve. Say for example, if I'm going to do a patient with a 26 millimeter and I am in the gray zone, which valve I have to use, we inflate the 23 millimeter balloon. If the 23 millimeter balloon was fitting more, so I can again go back to that 23 valve once more. To have the sizing, we have to understand the concept in that this Edward valve is the valve that change the geometry and shape of the aortic annulus. If it is not correct, definitely it will rupture it. So it came as the 3D annular area. This is the major way of getting the sizes. For example, a patient with an annulus of 338 millimeter by CT or by TEE 3D. It means if I take a 23 millimeter valve, the degree of oversizing will be 20. For sure, if this patient has a high risk criteria for annular injury, this patient will end up with annular rupture. But if the patient annulus is 415 millimeter and at a 23, the what we call the oversizing is minus 3.3. It means that the valve is smaller than the annulus, and this is quite effective when I have the skirt outer to the valve. It is helpful to what we call seal. This is extremely important. When we see the valve inflation, notice the inflow part of the valve as compared to the outflow part of the valve. The Sabian 3 valve, it take most of the shortening in the inflow part. Here we see three dots. The inflow part, because of the design of the valve, it shortened much more as compared to the outflow. So if I do not put this one into consideration during positioning of the valve, for sure I would miss the annulus. Again, let us look carefully to the Sabian valve. The annular valve comes in four sizes. It's a bovine pericardium and with an outer skirt with a cobalt chromium. It comes as a separate valve, crimped with a special crimper, and then inflated to the patient or inflated in the intra-annular. When I'm getting the measurements for this patient to pick up the size, it is very important to notice that if I look carefully, if I had the area measured in systole 20% of the RR, the area will be 461. While at the same patient, if I have it in diastole in 60% of the RR, the area will be 362. It is completely different. So we have to be very, very cautious that we have to pick up at 25 to 40% of the RR. And the second point, which is very crucial also, is very important that I cannot safely put the valve except if I see, which what we call it, the Kublener view. I have to see the three nadir parts of the leaflets on the same line because the valve is short profile, so easy it can miss the annulus. If we compare it to the Evolute R, this is a supra-annular valve. It is above the annulus. It is almost 13 millimeter above the annulus, so it is at the level of the coronary. It has some integration with the coronaries. It is very important to know that this valve is fitting to allow for adequate coronary perfusion or not. For any patients with Evolute R or self-expandable valve, I need to measure the perimeter because the perimeter, it does not change that significantly with the cardiac cycle. Also, I have to pick up the coronary height, the sinus of Valsalva width, which is the crucial for coronary perfusion. Again, we discussed this before. I will go through it fast. How to select the valve. Vascular access problem, the Evolute R, it can go down to 5 millimeter, but the minimal for the Sabian is 5.5 plus. Annular size, the smaller annular size, it is much preferred to have the supra-annular design, the Evolute R. The more calcium, especially the malignant type of calcium, and if the calcium is mainly incorporated in the LVOT or the aortic wall, the probability of annular rupture would be much higher. So this patient, it's much better to go with the self-expandable valve. Bicuspid and tricuspid will prove it that both are okay, but sometimes the self-expandable is less traumatic to the bicuspid valve. In valve, patients with patient prosthesis mismatch, it is much better to give the patient the chance for supra-annular design, which is the accessibility. This is no way to compare the accessibility of the coronaries through the Edward valve as compared to the core valve. As regard to the paravalvular leak, still, and nowadays the latest data, there is no significant difference between both, but due to the repositionability of the Evolute R, it can have a less paravalvular leak. Pacemaker rate, still the pacemaker rate is higher a little bit, and the newest data is improving for the difference between the Evolute self-expandable versus the balloon expandable. Stroke rate, it is marginally higher in the Edward valve as compared to the self-expandable valves, but still it does not transmit into clinical problems. So to select the Edward valve, has a robust data, easy to use, best coronary accessibility, horizontal aorta, Evolute R is repositionable, that you can take completely the valve back if you don't like it, less traumatic to the calcium, it is much better hemodynamics when we have a head-to-head comparison. Let us go to our initial problem here today, which is the bicuspid aortic valve. The bicuspid aortic valve had four arms. Etiology, this etiology of a congenital problem, it has its own hemodynamics, it starts from early life and with different morphologies. The treatment of bicuspid aortic valve usually is challenging, either surgical, medical, or nowadays with the TAVI percutaneous options. The diagnosis, usually we have a confusion in the imaging modality, and usually we underdiagnose the bicuspid aortic valve. In the complication side, we have aortopathic complication and valvulopathic complication. The aortopathic complication, either aortic dilatation, aneurysms, or dissection. For the valvulopathy, that we might have an aortic stenosis, pure aortic stenosis, pure aortic regurgitation, combination of both, infective endocarditis is quite circular dysfunction is expected. If we see the number or the percent of these or the prevalence of the bicuspid aortic valve, if you have your patient away from the rheumatic countries, below than 40, it is 100% a bicuspid valve. And the mean age of all of our population, it is 50 to 70% of our patients, they are bicuspid. But usually there is a problem. I hope that we can solve it today. The famous classification, Sievers classification, classify according to the number of raphe. into zero type, there is no RFA, one RFA, which is type 1, or two RFA, which is type 2. And newly, the newest and the best classification came, it's a CT-based. It, from my point of view, it solved a lot of confusion. It is classified into type 0 and type 1. Type 0, there is no RFA. We have two, almost two sinuses, two big leaflets, and the opening either horizontal, so the two coronaries will come from one leaflet side, or it is vertical, so each coronary will come from one side. The other group is bicommissural complete RFA type. This group, it can be, there is a RFA either between the left and right coronary or any others. The left and right contribute or constitute around 80% of the patients. And the third new, which is tricommissural incomplete RFA. What it means by incomplete RFA, the RFA does not go up to the level of the sinotubular junction. So it is at the base and the middle, but does not go up. So usually it gives us this impression that you have a tricuspid valve very nicely. It looks as tricuspid, but no, it's a bicuspid type 1 tricommissural incomplete RFA type, which is the most common group of these is the left to right, again, similar to the previous. Why we have a lot of discussion about the why there is a problem in the bicuspid valve? It is often heavily calcified, so does not allow full expansion. There is a significant prevalence or incidence of paravalvular leak, annular rupture, and frequently there is an associated aortic aneurysm with the risk of rupture, which is a disastrous and fatal on the spot. Oval-shaped annulus or oval-shaped opening does not allow a full circumferential opening or symmetrical opening of the valve. So the probability to have what we call a significant paravalvular leak and the non-uniformly opened valve might have a limited durability. This is why the most of the studies, they do not put the bicuspid aortic valve in their major trials. There's two questions Dr. Sharif will put. Let us see what is your opinion about it. The outcome of transcatheter aortic valve replacement in the group of balloon expandable valve, this is very important to study. It compared a huge number of patients in 550 sites. They tried to match this group of patients and they compared bicuspid patients versus tricuspid. Fortunately, as regard the stroke, there is no change. Mortality, there is no significant change. And also as regard to paravalvular leak, the outcome almost the same. What about the self-expandable? The STS and ACC team of 900 plus patients, and they compared the 1 year mortality, there was no significant difference between the bicuspid or the tricuspid as regard mortality in 1 year. Again, the degree of aortic regurgitation in both groups did not change. And the best data came from the bicuspid aortic valve registry when they collected almost 570 patients out of 6,000 patients. They tried to match one group of patients to be equalized, and then they noticed that there is no significance in mortality in 2 years mortality, and they compared early what we call generation devices versus recent or new generation devices. In early days, the blue one is the early, and the red one is the new. There was a significant paravalvular leak, which is improved, and the new pacemaker, it was there, but there was no significant in these days. Both came down. Failure to do the procedure, it was higher in the early generation. The 30-day to 1 year mortality, almost there is no significance. For the Sabian XT, with the improvement, the incidence of annular rupture decreased, the incidence of paravalvular leak decreased. For the core valve, the failure and the need for a second valve markedly decreased, the paravalvular leak decreased, and also the pacemaker rate also decreased. If we compared the devices itself, all comers, for as regard mortality, as regard morbidity, every the same. If we compared head to head, that the incidence of aortic root injury, it is almost the same. There is no significant change between both groups, either the balloon expandable or self-expandable in the context of bicuspid valve. Second valve implantation, numerically there is difference, but no significant difference. The paravalvular leak, again numerically, it is higher in the evolute R, but it is not significant. And the new pacemaker, which is very impressive, that there is difference in little bit increase in the Sibian 3 as compared to the evolute R, but again it is numerically only, but there is no significance. So it means that both valves are doing the job. Recently, 2 months back, mortality and pacemaker also both valves doing the same, clinical and procedural. The procedural technicality in the self-expandable valve is a little bit higher, but by the end, the outcome is the same. Now, let us go to our practice. How we are going to size? If we have a problem in the anatomy of the aortic annulus itself, do we count on the perimeter, the area, diameter, where we measure, at the annulus level, or at higher 4 millimeter up, or 8 millimeter up, or 12 millimeter even up? There is what we call the Bavard European registry. It gives us that most of the patients with the bicuspid aortic valve, the prosthesis under expansion is constant finding almost in bicuspid aortic valve. Annular base sizing is effective in 88% with minimal oversizing. The interconventional distance at 4 millimeter, it can be in the gray zone for this patient. This is how we are measuring. So if we take the annulus itself, this is the standard. It works in 88% of patients. And in this cut, we can see the interconventional distance at this level. And then you can, what we call, make a circle that taking the same diameter, and from this circle you get the area and the perimeter, so you will get the size of the valve you wanted to implant. Sizing according to the landing zone configuration, there is 3 different scenarios. Either the intercommensural distance is as equal as the diameter of the aortic annulus, so at 4 millimeter above, this is the level of the annulus, this is the intercommensural distance. If they are equal, there is no problem. There is a group of patients, when you see the annulus is smaller than the intercommensural distance, what is the measurement you will have to take? The smaller one. Another group, which is more common, that we have the annulus is bigger than the interconventional distance. What we have to use is the smaller one. So if we have matched interconventional distance, aortic annulus, whatever we take, there's no problem. If we have flared, we have to take the smaller one, which is the annular. If we have tapered, we have to take the smaller, which is the interconventional distance. Let us go to our first patient. We have an 83 years old male. He came with a severe heart failure. He has a chronic renal impairment. His echo revealed a bicuspid severe aortic stenosis with a mean gradient of 66 millimeter mercury with moderate aortic regurgitation. Left ventricular function is compromised. He is a COPD on home oxygen. His pulmonary artery pressure is 60 with normal coronary. The heart team considered him as a high risk for surgery, so he went to the TAVI. As we start, usually the peripheral vascular tree, it looks fine, tortuosity, mild tortuosity, but there is no calcification. Diameter-wise, the vessel is perfect. So what are the measurements? The sinus of Valsalva, it is 40 millimeter, and it's quite common. He has a very horizontal aorta because the annulo ventricular angle came as 68, and we defined that more than 48 is a horizontal aorta, and the calcium score was very high. When we take the measurements, the annulus came as an area 697, which is the extreme of the valve size. The annulus diameter, it came as almost 30. the intercommissural distance at 4 millimeter above, it came as almost 30. So for this patient, this is the type of patient that we have equal ICD to the aortic annulus. So what is the size we have to consider? The virtual basal ring as we are used, or the intercommissural, both are matched fortunately. What type of valve? What type of valve and size? The area driven, it can give you the choice of the valves, two chances. Either to go with the Sabian 3 with a nominal valve. So the degree of oversizing is -5%. What it means? It means that the valve is smaller than the annulus, so the probability to have an annular injury is much less. If we are going to use a self-expandable valve in a bicuspid, we have to use a balloon. For this patient, use the balloon, which is smaller than this diameter. 25 or 26 millimeter balloon will be more than enough for a self-expandable valve. But fortunately, for balloon expandable valve, you can go directly. Initially, we have to start to get the view that we can see what. Number one, the takeoff of the coronaries. This is very important in case if you have a need to access the coronary, you will see the distribution of the calcium and you will try to get the coplanar view. Access, the vessels are great. The insertion of the e-sheath over a regular wire or a stiff wire, it depends on the tortuosity, but this sheath is amazing sheath, so it can go easy. With this orthography, we try to get the coplanar view. We see the take of the left main and the distribution of the calcium, and we have to look carefully for the ascending aortopathy and to see the bicuspid, the sinotubular junction. The aortic valve was crossed, and when we see the wire came from the middle of the valve to the wall of the aorta, it means that this is a big commissure is opened and you have a good opening here. Again, from this view, you can appreciate how much this aorta is very horizontal. And this is how the junk of calcium and the coplanar view we can see. To do the valving, first of all, as we told before, we have to align the valve to balloon. So look carefully to the animation here. We pull back the balloon by pulling the shaft of this delivery system. So we will align the balloon. The three dots will be in the middle, exactly aligned with the valve. We take this shot, some cranial angulation in the AP, exactly match it with the valve. Then we have to move clockwise this macro knob to negotiate around the arch to allow you to cross. And then we have to take the pusher back to allow the balloon freely to inflate. And then if we would like to do fine tuning of the valve itself, by moving this small knob, you can move the valve up and down. Finally, after fine positioning and rapid pacing, you ensure that the valve in good position, you will inflate. And remember, don't forget that the degree of shortening here is from the valve from down, much, much bigger than up. This is crossing the aortic valve, still the pusher supporting the valve to cross this junk of calcium. We need to have some traction over this wire. And once we are in good position, remember to take care of the pusher. It is behind the first marker and the valve in the middle of the middle marker at the root of exactly the position of the annulus itself. And once we are okay, we have to check the pacemaker. Constant, stable, 10 consecutive beat with adequate physiological circulatory arrest or circulatory modification. The systolic blood pressure should be lower than 50. The pulse pressure should be below than 10 is achieved for this patient at 200 beat per minute rate. So we can go and inflate the valve slowly with fine tuning of the valve, with fine in and out till we achieve the proper position. After inflating the valve, we check that the annulus did not injure, and we can see the coronary perfusion looks fine, ascending aorta looks fine. Pressure tracing, it's amazing, and we don't have any vascular complication. This patient went home safe with no aortic regurgitation, with very good valve, and on the third day, he was doing very nice. Now, we'll move to another challenge in the what we call in the Sabian valve. We have a medical practitioner. He is 43 years only. he was presented with dyspnea class 3 to 4. He denies any other complaints. His laboratory, he is a big man. His hemoglobin is low, is almost at 200, and he has an elevated liver markers, low albumin, and high NR. His ESR and CRP were in normal range almost, and his PNP was extremely high. His echo revealed ejection fraction is poor. Ejection fraction is almost 20 with moderate mitral regurgitation. Bicuspid aortic valve, we can see here, this is the bicuspid aortic valve, and almost there is one raphe here, so it's the commonest, which is the right to left raphe. Here we can appreciate the very poor left ventricle, and he has a mild tricuspid regurg. Pulmonary artery pressure came as 70. This aortic valve had a severe incompetence and severe stenosis. And what is impressive also, he has a significantly severe RV dysfunction. What is it challenging? This one is the big annulus. So this is the anatomy of the patient. He has a severe diastolic dysfunction. This is the tricuspid envelope, which is almost 60. He has a severe diastolic dysfunction. We can see that the mitral valve apparatus is posteriorly displaced. But this patient, he was not happy to hear this. So he refused everything and went against medical advice. In 2 weeks' time, he came to the emergency. Code blue, the patient was presented in cardiogenic shock and arrested for 2 minutes. Then he revived, fortunately without intubation. Now he is on inotropic support. We calculated his risk score. He came as morbidity, mortality, almost 90% of this patient to have morbidity and mortality, and his mortality is almost 34%. So it's extremely high risk. If we calculate our, what we call end stage damage or end organ damage, this patient has a poor left ventricular function, he has a mitral regurgitation, he has a pulmonary hypertension, and he has a severe right ventricular dysfunction. So this patient, after successful TAVI, is expected to have a 1 year, almost a 20% mortality. So this is the extreme edge. What are the challenges in this patient? He is on cardiogenic shock, we don't have a CT, we don't have area. His annulus is very big. It's a 30 millimeter by echo, which is very big. And the intercommissural distance by echo is 30 millimeter. Almost, this is above the IFU for Sabian 3 valve. What do we need for this patient, a circulatory support or not? This is an important question. If we look carefully to his peripheral, this is not a peripheral for a 40 years patient. But remember, patient coming with cardiogenic shock, he will have this type of vessels. So if you know the patient before, and if you look carefully, the common femoral artery, if SFA, if you compare it to the iliac artery, this is, it's almost a very spasmed vessels due to the vasopressors and due to the shock. One of our colleagues asked me last time about how to get the coplanar view. This is one big tail in the right coronary. This is another big tail in the non-coronary. And we assume that the third one is here. So both are the same level in the middle of this aortic root. So we expect that this is the level of the coplanar view here. This is the left, right, and the non-coronary. And I try to get you how it looks. This is left, right, and the non-coronary. And this patient, due to his very bad cardiac output, we could not stabilize the balloon. We cannot do him a long rapid pacing. This is a 25 millimeter balloon. Where is the annulus here? If you follow the non-coronary cusp, this is the end of the cusp, and this is the start up of the, what we call it, it's the annulus here. And from the left side, this is the annulus here. And so this is the patient annular diameter. If this is a 25 millimeter balloon, this is almost one-fifth of the diameter of this balloon is here. So the annulus of the patient here is almost 30. And remember, this is almost an REO, and the REO is a smaller diameter even than the LAO. So this patient is really challenged. So we overinflated the balloon with a 4 mil. As we know that 4 mil will give you almost 2 millimeter. This is the 31, not 32. 4 mil will give you a 31 millimeter valve diameter. So with the slow inflation, we can see here we could position the valve in almost a very, very good height. With the full inflation, the valve came almost at 1 to 2 millimeter, and with the inflation, but still the balloon and the wire is in, so you can see some valvular incontinence. But if you look carefully to the paravalvular, there is no paravalvular leak. And this patient, he had a very good outcome. His bedside echo was a trace of AI, gradient was perfect, mild MR, but his left ventricle did not improve. In 3 years later, he had a good valve function, trace of AI, the gradient in the same, mild MR, ejection fraction came normal, RV function came normal, pulmonary artery pressure came normal, renal profile came normal. We will see this patient in the complication because he has a late mild valve migration. We will see it. Now we will shift to one of the most interesting topics, which is the degenerated bioprosthesis. This is very important. No one will work TAVI will not face a degenerated aortic valve bioprosthesis. We have a 71 years old male. He had a progressive shortness of breath. He is diabetic, hypertensive, dyslipidemic, and atrial fibrillation, also COPD and mild renal impairment with low creatinine clearance. This patient in 2007, he had a Bintel surgery and he has a mild aortic bioprosthesis magna 25 millimeter. And he had a PCI in 2013 due to an anterior wall MI. His echo, ejection fraction 25 to 30%, and severe AS, severe eccentric AI with moderate MR. His angio, the stent is patent and no other coronary obstructive lesion. This is, we can see the ascending Bintel or the tube here. This is the shadow of the tube. It's not the normal aorta. And here we can see the reverberation of the valve. This is a significant severe eccentric aortic regurgitation. And this is how the shadow of the valve, it locks down. So if we have a patient coming for valve in valve, what we need to know? Number one, the type of the surgical valve, the model and size of this valve. What is the true diameter of this valve? What are the fluoroscopic landmarks, because it is variable? What is the procedural risk for this patient? Is he expected to have a coronary obstruction, residual gradient, what we call it, patient prosthesis mismatch, and if this patient is suitable for this or not? We will start with identification of the valves available in the market. We categorize them into two groups, stented or stentless. The stented group is again classified into two groups, the regular stented and the other group, which is the rapid deployment or the sutureless valves. It's only three in the market. This is the Perse valve from Sorin. This is the Enable from Medtronic, Intuity from Edward. This is the only three available in the market. And according to the leaflets, we have either porcine leaflets or we have all, this is bovine leaflets. So this is bovine leaflets, this is porcine leaflets. Again, another classification, either the leaflets are internally mounted, so the leaflets are internal to the cage of the bioprosthesis, or externally mounted as mitroflow or trifecta. This is two different, actually it's a hemodynamically good valves, but for the TAVI business, it's very silly valves. So we have stented valves and we have a stentless valve. The stentless valve is an aortic root, either it is a homograft or freestyle or the Toronto. In Egypt, we have the Toronto and freestyle. The homograft is the best one. It can serve any patient with aortic root infective endocarditis. For the percutaneous valves, because we are coming to do a TAVI in TAVI in short time, this is the what we call the portfolio available. So number one, the question is, what is the type of the valve? This is a magna, and this is how it looks under the fluoroscopy. And this is the footprint of different valves. We have a lot of valves. We should know how it looks in the X-ray. This is the Mitroflow. This is the Medtronic mosaic valve. And this is the trifecta from St. Jude. Now, if we are going to size, there is no more what we call the native aortic valve virtual ring. It is not there. Now we have the surgical heart valve ring. We need to know what we call the inner diameter and the valve size itself. But what we mean is the inner diameter, because this is inside this cage we are going to put our valves. What is very good in the new days that the resilient tissue valve came from Edward, that it is an expandable valve, that you can expand it with a balloon, and this without any risk to the annulus for the patient in case if you have a patient prosthesis mismatch. This is one of the most important classification for any patient going for a valve in valve. Number one, look to the what we call the biprosthesis, to the relation to the coronary. If the upper part of the biprosthesis is below the coronary, this is what you call type 1. If the biprosthesis is above the level of the coronaries, but below the level of the sinotubular junction, we have two types. Either that's the sinotubular junction, the sinus of Valsalva is big, and this is less risk, or this type which is effaced or very narrow sinuses. The other third group, that the valve is higher than the sinotubular junction, we have three different categories. One of them, we have a very good big sinus of Valsalva, so the coronaries are away. Or if we have an effaced coronaries, effaced sinuses, so the sinuses are narrow. Or the STJ itself is narrow, but the sinuses are big. Every one of these count for the risk for coronary artery occlusion. As we know that the bioprosthetic valve, the risk of coronary occlusion is much, much higher. For our patient, the type of valve is stented valve, Magna 25. The true diameter is 23, so he is fitting to 26 Edward or a core valve 29. His fluoroscopic markers, we need to go 2 millimeter below the surgical sewing ring. The risk of coronary procedure risk, if he has a coronary obstruction risk, we might need a basilica. If he expected to have a residual gradient, we might be in need to do a valve fracture. So this is exactly, we can use the application, which is an iPhone and Windows based application. It's very, very nice that you can get every type of valve you need to get all the information you need. Another extremely important measurements we have to get from the CET, what we call VTC, valve to coronary distance. If the valve outer ring of the valve to the orifice of the coronary more than 4 millimeter, you are safe to the what we call the compression of the coronaries with the valve in valve. For this patient, we had him to the cath lab. We have the angio to see the orifice of the coronaries and to do what we call alignment, or what we call orientation, or to remove the barracks of the valve itself. We have two options, either to put two hinge in one side and the third in one side, or to do the three on the same. This is both, it works. Whatever you like to do, you can put it here or you can put it this way. And again, we can, with echo, we can measure the VTC. This is the valve and this is the orifice of the coronary. It came also as 6 to 7 millimeter. Here, how to align the valve to pull it, the balloon to be mounted inside position, and then how we cross the valve. It is easy to cross. We avoid do a pre-balloon for the bioprosthetic valves, and then under rapid pacing we do a very gentle slow inflation to make sure that we are going to exactly position our valve in our position. Now you can see that this balloon needs to have an extra volume. This is with an extra volume 1 mil. This valve is nicely expanded. Here is the post implantation. This is the suture line for the previous pintel. Coronary perfusion, ostium, it looks very nice. It's far away, and the valve, it looks fine. Here in the echo also, we can see we have a very good coronary perfusion. We don't have a risk of the coronary. So for a patient with bioprosthetic failure, we have the options to go either ways. If the patient presented mainly with patient prosthesis mismatch, the first choice is to use a supraannular valve. And if there is a significant gradient, more than 20 post the procedure, you can what we call fracture the valve itself. The bioprosthetic valve can be fractured, can be expanded to decrease the gradient as much as you can. We will shift it to another case of an Evolute R Pro. This is an extension to the previous time to see how we are going to do with this patient. So first of all, we need to take a zoomed image to see the aortic root. If you look carefully here, we can see the left coronary, the right coronary, and non-coronary cusp for the patient. When we have our wire crossed, look carefully where the wire is stay in the middle. It means that these valve commissures are completely fused or a very tight orifice, or it moved to the wall here because this is the aortic wall. It means the commissure is open, so this patient might not be in need for a balloon. This patient is a 60-year-old male presented with exertional syncope and progressive shortness of breath in the last 4 weeks. He had 35 years of hypertension and newly diabetic. His chronic renal failure on regular hemodialysis. His echo, severe AS. His annulus was measured less than 18. Our aortic valve area calculated as 0.5. His gradient came as 110 over 66. Mild aortic regurgitation, mitral regurgitation, and diastolic dysfunction. His coronary angio revealed a subtotal ostial RCA, which is a codominant vessel with significant proximal LAD disease, severely calcified aortic root. The heart team rejected due to small annulus because, as we know from the surgical, what we call definitions, the annulus less than 23 is a small aortic annulus, and usually the patient will come with a patient prosthesis mismatch if you implant them a small valve, and the small valve carries a much more mortality on the 2 years of follow-up and the early degeneration of the valve. The CT perimeter came as 64 millimeter and the annulus came as 21, still and a small annulus type. His height of the right and left coronaries were adequate. Sinus of Valsalva were a little bit tight. It's a 26, 26, 27. If we have this, we are going to do an Evolute for this patient. The Evolute R, we are counting on the perimeter. The 26 millimeter valve will start from 62 to 72. So this patient in the early context of the 26 size. This is his echo. We have a posterior leaflet calcification. We have a severe calcification of the ascending aorta here. We have some mitral, some aortic regurgitation, and here we can see an off-plane, severely calcified aortic root. Again, to do a balloon, this is a revision from the last time. If we are planned our patient, if our patient is well planned, we know that we don't have enough imaging modalities to give us the answer which type of valve. We have to do a balloon interrogation. We inflate a defined sized balloon in a defined pressure with compliance chart well known. We will identify the size and the risk of coronary occlusion. This is if the patient does not have enough preoperative imaging assessment. If he has, but we know the risk of this patient need to have an easier facilitated procedure, patient with hemodynamic instability, severe kidney disease, LV dysfunction, COPD, or severe pulmonary hypertension, this patient will go directly with the valve to both the valve, what we call direct TAVI insertion without a pre-balloon. If the patient has a pre-modality, but he has a severe or asymmetrical valve calcification, has LVOT calcification, horizontal aorta, bicuspid valve, junk of calcium at the landing zone, it is much preferred to do a pre-balloon dilatation. If the patient is a straightforward, non-critical aortic stenosis, absence of severe aortic regurgitation, and the mean gradient is not that high, so we can go safely with direct implantation. This is the most important 3 minutes or 4 minutes in the core valve. Now we put the valve in the aortic root. What we have to look carefully here, this is look carefully to here. This is the ring. This ring is the tip of the valve. What is the problem of this ring? When we look carefully here, this ring is defined as the valve is what we call in parallax. This valve is t- tilted. If you open the valve, it will open by this way. If it open by this way, it is very easy that it can miss the aneurysm. What we have to do is to change our orientation. If we look caudally and only caudally, you will see that this ring has became as a line. And if you see, the valve did not move from position, but here the valve became much higher because this is a proper image. And we have to see the valve in this way when it opens, that you see that all these cells are overlapped from the one it is toward the anterior and the posterior tip. Again, what we have to do here, now this valve in what we call in the neutral position. In the neutral position, that the valve, we put it, the wire is deep in the apex, and by pushing the valve a little bit and then pushing the wire, this valve will align itself again. To imagine what is the anatomy, this is the non-coronary, this is the left coronary, and the right coronary is a little bit up here. If we have the valve in this position, we expect when we put the valve by this way, we had, remember that we had caudal view, so the right coronary cusp is above this level. So if we put the valve by this way, we are sure that we are covering the left and non-coronary. What about the right? 100% it is covered because it is above the level of the two other cusps. But it cannot be if you try to correct the ring by moving cranial. Because if you move cranial, the position of this cusp will be a little bit down. Again, now when we have the valve, first of all, we need to put what we call node zero. We do unsheath for the valve. So the sheath moved from this position, that the sheath was here, and it moved back to the tip of the valve here. We can see that the sheath at the tip of the valve, and then we move again more. We can see that the sheath, it is a little bit dark image, but I hope that you can see the tip of the sheath here in the first marker, which is almost 6 millimeter distance. So this is the position we can see. The sheath was here first. Now when we unsheath the tip of the sheath, now at the tip of the valve, we call it node zero. For this one, now the tip of the sheath was beyond the first marker, which is the 6 millimeter. This is the first step of punch. You move the sheath more. So moving the sheath more, we will have it here on the second. The distance between the tip and the first one, this is 6 millimeter. From this row to the second one is 4 millimeter. So now the tip of the sheath is 10 millimeter away from the tip of the valve. Notice that the wire is well engaged in the apex, and the sheath is almost aligned. Native valves is working. Take care that the valve native is working. You can stay long, but not in a small cavity, in LV dysfunction, severe mitral regurgitation, severe pulmonary hypertension, or poor RV. Why? Because once the valve is inside, you have a significant aortic regurgitation. How much the heart can tolerate, it depends. Now, deploying the valve, when we are in the optimal position, we start to unsheath very, very slowly till we do an annular contact. The other end of the valve touched the left coronary. At this stage, the native valve is not now working, and we have to stop at before what we call the area of no return. If this ring crossed this black loop sockets, it means that I cannot recapture the valve, so I lose one of the major function of the valve itself. Again, I have to look carefully to the tip of the valve to make sure that I don't have any parallax. If the valve is tilted in this view, it will be misleading that you don't know exactly where is the valve. You have to correct the image and then to take a shot to see the tip of the valve in this one and not this one. This is a very good image. When we inject, we have to make sure that the valve in the proper target position and there is a good coronary perfusion and there is no parallax of the tip of the valve. Once we are okay in position, we are ready to release the valve. We take the what we call the tension of the wire a little bit back, and slowly we are opening the valve on a fast basing, which is 120, and we have to maintain some push against the system till we have the two loops are completely released. after we release, look carefully of the valve. When we just released, look carefully here, the valve is tilted. What it means that the one towards us is at this depth, but the other one is almost 7 millimeter above. So if you inject here, you don't know exactly where is the level of the valve. So what I have to do is to correct this one. Do you see? This is the upper part, this is the inflow part. So this valve has no parallax at all. Now with injection, we can see a very good coronary perfusion, and the depth here is 6 millimeter. This patient is young. I need to make sure of this. Do you see what it is? This is the new leaflet, which is below the level of the left main. So, and also I see a full leaflet in the orifice of the coronary. So it means that this coronary is coming in the middle of this leaflet. So if I'm going to do another valve in valve, probably I would do basilica for this one, but this is a patient who is safe to have another valve in valve or TAVI in TAVI later on. His iliacs came as very good. So my final thoughts that, again, bicuspid aortic stenosis is no longer a major restriction for TAVI. Enough evidence supported equality in outcome compared to tricuspid aortic stenosis. The new generation balloon expandable and self-expandable valves proved themselves in TAVI as almost equal in safety and valve function in short and intermediate term. Aortic valve in valve is now considered safe alternative to surgery in well-selected groups of patients according to their risk of coronary occlusion. TAVI is the procedure of minute details, and all operators need to master all imaging modalities to get its synergistic value. Patients need requires mastering at least these two valves or their equivalent to achieve better TAVI portfolio in your lab. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Reda. Very excellent presentation. You have a question. If you want the third question about the charge anticoagulant, do you want to ask the audience about this question?
Yes, yes. Whatever the questions you would like, because I did not see
this question.
Okay, this is the first question. The question say here, the discharge anticoagulation plan post-TAVI, either NUAC, aspirin alone, ADB blocker alone, aspirin plus ADB blocker, ADB blocker plus NUAC, vitamin K antagonist. So try to vote. We have what we call 30 seconds. We are waiting for the reply. Till we have the reply, Sharif, what is the next question? You had two questions in the
That's very... okay.
It's okay. Till now, I think everyone is voting the right answer, which is that almost 74% of our population, they give that the dual antiplatelet is still the 2A guidelines till now. Some of our colleagues, they give a vitamin K antagonist. It's a correct answer when the patient is on a direct what we call indication for vitamin K antagonist. Again, another question came, another answer from some colleagues that what we call the Plavix alone as an indication, it can be, it's also a 2B when the patient has a high risk of bleeding. So I think this is very good answers. The other question is, for better TAVI outcome in bicuspid aortic valve, we undersize the valve or we oversize to avoid paravalvular leak? Let us see the answer. Again, we discussed before, there is a rule in the bicuspid valve in how we selected the size, where we selected the size. I see that we have more or less similar answers till now, but now start to improve. That undersizing of the valve is the clue for many reasons. First of all, the radial force of the self-expandable valve, if it is excessive, you will not be able to position the valve in its position because the radial force will push the valve away from its target destination. And this is the one you don't like. For a balloon expandable valve, one of the major risk for this patient for annular injury is significant oversizing. If you notice the one patient we presented that we bought a minus 5% of the size, it is the Sabian 3, it is a nice valve, it can do the job for a nice up to 7%, minus 7%, it will do the job. So this is an excellent answer. Oversizing will not solve, but maybe the type of the valve. And in some cases, if you are going to choose to rupture the annulus or to put the valve efficiently and then to come back to put a closure device. But thank you for the answers. The last question, Ya Sharif. Is one question more? Yes, again, this is the question that we need to think before we answer. For better TAVI outcome, balloon expandable valve or self-expandable valve, which one you prefer?
30 seconds.
This is sound answers that we expect that we have. We have what we call it. It's more or less equality in the outcome for both valves, the self-expandable and the balloon expandable. But two issues. In patients with bicuspid, with very severe horizontal aorta, with reasonable calcification, the balloon expandable valve will be perfect. Patients with excessive calcium and the non-horizontal, the self-expandable valve will do the job. The self-expandable valve, more or less, it is more forgiving. The leaflet's design, it can work with an oval shape more marginally, not significantly, better than the balloon expandable valve. And when you have a massive calcification, especially if the annulus is more or less in the smallish size, it can be a risk for annular rupture with the balloon expandable valve. Thank you very much for these answers. It is very convenient to me to have these answers.
Thank you, Dr. Reda. Dr. Ahmed Tamara with you. Dr. Ahmed Tamara? Okay, until he comes. There's a mini question for you, Dr. Reda. I have a question for you. If the patient...
Okay, let us ask one point, one favor, because some of our colleagues, they are not talking Arabic. So please, let us stick back to the English language. Okay. The question will be understood by all of our colleagues.
Okay, I have a question. If the patient have a horizontal aorta,
yes,
what will prefer the type of aorta, what valve? And if you have no options for core valve, what's the trick to put it without to adjust this valve?
The answer here first. Why the Sabian, it can't solve this problem? If you look carefully to the large, what we call knob in the delivery system, you can say, for example, this is a normal, it's not a horizontal aorta. The horizontal aorta will come like this. So to correct this one, because now you are angulated to the annulus. So if you do some flexion more, you will have the valve will come like this. So the ability to do flexion of the delivery system usually facilitate orientation of this valve to be perpendicular over the annulus exactly as it should be. For the core valve, what you have to do, there is a lot of tricks. Number one, you have to make sure that when you go with the wire should be stable enough inside the cavity of the left ventricle, and then you push the whole system deep in. When the system is coming deep in, and you push the wire exactly as you are doing with the coronary. When you push the wire, the guide will come back. So when you push the wire, what will happen? It will not move like this. It will first go to the wall, and then it will start to come up. So manipulating the wire and the delivery system will help the system to come from here to here. I have one slide that if I can see it to you, it's one of the slides that I canceled. I did not present it, but I think it gave you the answer for this one. Again, this is a slide which is, I think it's important. If you look carefully, this is your question. When you have the catheter is like this, you need to correct this angle. To correct this angle, you have to play with the wire, because this is the annulus plane. Your valve from this point will be 3 millimeter, and from the other point will be 14 millimeter. If your what we call maneuver was not proper, after you release the valve, it will migrate to the apex because it is not well compressed symmetrically from everywhere. Okay.
Okay. Dr. Ahmed Tamara and Dr. Khair Abdain with us. Can you share with us, Dr. Ahmed Tamara? Dr. Khair Abdain? Dr. Ahmed Tamara? Okay. We can let Dr. Khair Abdain, you hear me? If you want to comment, any comments? We will start the audience will have a question, so I will start with Dr. Khalid Rifat. Dr. Khalid Rifat, you have the mic now.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much, Dr. Reda, for the very impressive presentation, as usual. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dr. Khalid.
I would just ask about two subjects. First of all, about the valve-in-valve in condition of degenerated by prosthetic valve. Do you think that the stented valves, they do have a better options for a valve-in-valve compared to the stentless? This is my first question. And in terms of degeneration of the bicuspid aortic valve, we have different, most of them, they do have aortic regurgitation and aortic stenosis combined, rather than pure aortic stenosis. Does this affect the decision of the type of valve in such conditions, having a severe aortic regurgitation rather than just aortic stenosis? Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Khalid. This is two nice questions. First of all, if we look carefully to the two different types of the bioprosthesis, usually when we say, for example, we have a 25 magna valve, it means that the 25 is the outer part of the valve. Here it is 25 millimeter. And when we have the stentless valve, we say the 25 is the inner. So by default, usually the stentless valve, they are bigger. And the outcome of these patients is different in as compared to the stented valves. Usually, the rate of extensive calcification to the homograft or to the freestyle is the commonest, to have it massively calcified. But the outcome for both, usually this one, not all, have one advantage and other disadvantage. The one advantage that most of them, they don't have this highest risk of coronary occlusion. The major disadvantage that they are radiolucent, you don't see anything. You don't see the what we call the skeleton of the base of the valve. So you need to be extremely cautious in doing this, what we call valve in valve. So as regarded the risk, I can say that the outcome of the stent valve is better than the small stented valve. These type of two valves, they are the worst, especially when they are small. The risk of coronary occlusion is extremely high, especially in 19 and 21 millimeter size. And usually we need to fracture them. When we fracture, these leaflets will go directly to the left main. So in this type, this is much more risky. But when you have the Edwards type valves in this group, or even the mosaic valve from Medtronic, these valves, usually if you have a good size, the probability to have a coronary artery occlusion is much less. But the risk is coming from here, and these valves, usually they are bigger, and the risk of coronary is less. The other part of your question is is it different for a combined lesion, aortic incontinence with an aortic regurgitation? We presented two patients. Both patients, they have a different category. The second one was both left ventricular function. He has a very big annulus. And this patient will present to him in the complication because in spite he has a very good acute position, acute hemodynamics in good position, the valve is still, after 3 years, is doing a perfect job, but the valve is migrated due to the less anchor. When you have a combined pathology, the anchor is less. So if the patient in the extreme edge, so the risk of migration or failure is more or less higher. But this is a small percent of the what we call bicuspid valves. To have it in a very large annulus in combined aortic regurgitation, more or less, very less calcium. So the risk of improper valving, it is much more difficult as compared to pure calcific aortic stenosis. So if I choose, I don't mind which one, but I have to be away from the extreme large annulus type.
Okay, thank you so much.
My pleasure, Dr. Khaled.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Khaled. Dr. Ahmed Tamara, Dr. Khair Abdain. Dr. Ahmed Tamara, please.
السلام عليكم. بارك الله فيك يا دكتور. انا اسف والله, بس كان شريف كان قافل عندي الميوت والانميوت. ربنا يبارك فيك يا شريف يعني, فبحاول اتكلم, ما كنتش عارف. بطمنكم على دكتور ابراهيم, الامور الحمد لله تمام. ميرسي يا دكتور رضا, تحياتي لجميع الحضور. بليز يا شريف, بروسيد وذ ذا كويستشنز.
ثانك يو فيري ماتش دكتور احمد.
Sorry, Dr. Ahmed Tamar. We have a question from Dr. Kumar. You have the mic now, you can open it.
Hello.
Hi, Kumar.
Hi, Dr. Reda. This was a very nice presentation, as usual. You are so kind and explain each and everything in very much detail, comprehensive way. The question that I want to ask about your case that you presented, the second case, which was a young male patient having LV ejection of 20% with severe aortic regurgitation with severe aortic stenosis. You put a valve and patient ejection fraction improved. So the question I want to ask you that is there any study or you are performing TAVI for aortic regurgitation solely?
First of all, this is what we call, it's the extreme type of patients that I don't wish or I don't like anyone to face this type. This patient, beforehand, we supposed to do him what we call a dobutamine myocardial reserve study before, or an MRI to assess if this patient has a myocardial reserve or not. What is good for this patient, he is young. In spite of the left ventricle, it looks very poor, and it takes long time to recover to its original function. If we have a pure aortic stenosis, you know that up to 20% of this ventricle, they recover very early. But the combination for an aortic stenosis with an aortic regurg, it's difficult to have it. The other problem is this patient, when he came to us, he came in emergency. This patient, he went to DAMA against medical advice. He did not believe that we said. So we did not have enough time to complete his study to know what is happening. So this was a salvage procedure, but fortunately it came good. Very minimal calcium, bicuspid valve, a combination of pure aortic stenosis and the pure and the aortic incontinence, very, very large annulus, more left ventricle, more right ventricle. But these valves, actually, the patients usually recover very early if you have a successful unload of the ventricle. So if I have the patient coming in the regular way, I have to assess the left ventricular recoverability and associated coronary artery, if we have a coronary, and how the MRI tells what is the degree of myocardial reversibility of this LV dysfunction. If the myocardium is almost fibrosed, scarred, blah, blah, blah. But young patients usually still you expect that they can recover. But this is not the way to do this type of patients. We have to prepare them very, very well, especially pure aortic regurgitation. The final answer, our final part of your question is that pure aortic regurgitation can be done with TAVI, with the new generation devices. It can be, but it needs much, much more depth, much more care. Careful assessment and evaluation for the sizing, because the IFU of the companies does not work for the aortic regurgitation.
I have heard that certain new valves, just like a Jenny valve, they have came into market that has been used for the AR. What do you see?
Yes, this is the exactly the two valves that was dedicated for the Jena valve, the J valve, the engager valves. But till the moment, they don't have enough robust data or enough what we call convincing data to go with these valves as an isolated aortic regurgitation valves. If you have a good familiarity with the valves and you do not exceed the IFU, you can do the at least the calcific pure aortic regurgitation easy without any problem.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Kumar.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar. Dr. Muhammad Amin, you have a question? Dr. Muhammad Amin?
Aywa.
Okay, go on.
Thanks, Dr. Reda, for your elegant and informative presentation.
Thank you very much, Muhammad.
Dr. Reda, two questions about bicuspid aortic valve. Number one, if the patient has aortopathy dilated aortic valve, is there any cut point for the cut point number for dilated aorta, you will refuse or accept the patient for TAVI?
Okay, so as the guidelines in bicuspid aortic valve, you are in difference between 4.5 to 5 according to which guidelines you are following. If the patient has more than 4.5, the patient
Jalwani
should
go for Walaikum salam.
The patient should...
Chayamaya, sir.
The patient should go for surgery. Okay. If the patient is not surgical, but still in the gray zone of the 4.5 to 5, I prefer for this patient, if he is not surgical and turn it down from the surgical team, we can take the patient. In this type of patients, I prefer to go with the self-expandable valves to avoid balloon trauma of this aortopathic aorta, to avoid any direct aortic injury. So okay. Exactly as your guidelines, 4.5 to 5.
Okay. Second one, is there a certain type of bicuspid aortic valve has worse or better prognosis? And is there any tips and tricks for regarding the types of bicuspid aortic valve when you do TAVI?
Again, this is an excellent question, Muhammad. I did not like to make it complex for you, but if you look carefully to the presentation, we have the different types of the bicuspid valves. We need to look to what we call the subtype classification of these bicuspid valves is depends on two issues. Number one, the patient has from this view, we can see that the patients are grouped into three subgroups. Patients, they have RFE or not. So no RFE, or RFE without calcification, or calcified RFE. This is three progressive scores. Or the second is the amount of leaflet calcification. The mild leaflet calcification, moderate leaflet calcification, severe leaflet calcification. So if you have a patient with severe leaflet calcification plus calcified RFE, this is the type of patient with a higher risk. There is a lot of examples for these patients, but the less calcified leaflets, the non-calcified RFE are a better group or less risky groups.
Okay. The last one, if the patient has a degenerated aortic valve by prosthesis and the homograft, the patient has re-implanted coronaries. Now the problem will be in the positioning of the TAVI valve. Your tips and the tricks?
Actually, there is no tips and tricks here because it's you need to have a CT to know where is it. If you are able to define exactly the takeoff of the coronaries, you can align the Edward valve. Say, for example, if I know that the coronary is at 3 o'clock as usual, I put the three commissures of the Edward valve at 12 and 8 and 4. This will help us to have the proper position. And if we are using the evolute R again to put the midtronic up and to be tilted between 1 to 11 o'clock, usually this will align. So it is a matter of CT, pre-planning for these difficult type of patients. We'll present one of the complication, one of these type of patients next time.
Okay, thank you.
Inshallah. Thank you very much, Mohammed.
Dr. Javid.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This is Dr. Javid Sial from Pakistan, and enjoying this lecture of a great teacher, great Dr. Reda.
Thank you, though it's
midnight in Pakistan because we are 3 hours ahead of Egypt time. I have two very important questions and comments. Number one, majority of cases are in the last week and in this week, I've seen on-table imaging. I want your input on-table imaging, especially transesophageal echocardiography, which I have rarely seen in your cases, number one. Number two, in today's discussion, we learned the basilica as well. How much your experience, how frequently you encounter complication where you need basilica in your patients? Thank you.
Thank you very much, brother. First of all, if you go to the last thoughts, my last slide is you need to get the best benefit from all needed what we call imaging modalities if you need. When we have patients, say for example, he has different hemodynamic problems and you need to get more imaging information, especially if your patient was not properly prepared. So the TEE is very important. The second point, I do advise for all patients are going for valve in valve, they should have a TEE if they are not crystal clear with no risk of coronary occlusion. Are sure that this patient with a preoperative evaluation that you don't have any possibility of getting the coronary to be occluded, I prefer not to use the TEE to what we call to facilitate your TAVI. No need to go to general anesthesia, but it is integral to give you piece of information. You can see the flow to the left main. If you have a problem, you can see the VTC and you can see how the leaflets are pushed away against the coronary. It is helpful. This is as regard the TEE. As regarded the basilica is a technique we lacerate the leaflet, provided the middle of the leaflet in front of the tick of the coronary. So when you split the leaflets, you get it away from the orifice of the coronary. It cannot be by talks, it should be by description. In the next presentation, in the complication, we present one or two cases of basilica. You will see are doing it, how it works. The basilica is what we call a salvage technique. You have to know it very well. You have to know how to do it. And all my coming colleagues, my next generation, who are going to do a TAVI in TAVI, at least 20% to even more might be in need for basilica. So this technique is important technique to be trained for. Okay. Okay, Jawid. Thank you very much, Jawid.
Dr. Muhammad Azirgal, write a question about the sizing of the bicuspid valve at the level of annulus or at the level of refractory.
Again, this is a good question. This is the best came from the European data. That what, how we are going to size. This is an example. This is, if you can see here, this is the regular way with the annulus. This is the nadir of the three sinuses that we can see. This is the true annulus. Here we take the area. We do not take most of the calcium lumps, we exclude them. So this is the annulus, and this is the annulus-driven diameter, which is here almost the average, which is almost 28.5, okay? And then go 4 millimeter above this point, you will see this. When you see the view here, you will see that this is the intercommissural distance. Be curved line, but both are the same. So you measure this distance. So now you have two measurements. You have one, which is the intercommissural distance, ICD, and you have the area. Then you go to this graph. Compare the intercommissural distance to the regular area or perimeter measured annulus. If they are the same, this is 29, and this came as 29, so you will pick up the valve, whatever the diameter, because both are the same. If you have another group of patients, the annular diameter was smaller than the intercommissural diameter, you will pick up the annular diameter. If you have the intercommissural distance, if the smaller one, you will pick up the intercommissural distance. So if you are, they are equal, no difference. If there is two different measurements, you have to take the smaller one. Because you, if you take the smaller and the annulus valve ceiling will enough. And if you have the leaflet site is the place of or the site of ceiling, putting the valve in high position will treat this one also. So you get both measurements. 88% of the patients will go with the annulus. There are some patients, gray group, you have to respect. And this is different from area to area. In your country, in Pakistan, there is a discrepancy between both. This ICD is a little bit smaller than the aortic annulus. So all patients, you have to take both. And then you have to consider what in the smaller diameter, and then from the smaller diameter, you will get it. Okay?
Okay. Muhammad Azrigal have another question. He said that crossed wire may be entrapped within the cordy. How to be sure to avoid?
This is a good question. Usually, when you go, you cross the aortic valve, we cross only with the wire. Till you are in the LVOT, you should not push the wire more. Once you just crossed, don't push the wire more. Push the catheter itself, and you make sure that you go with the loop of the catheter rather than the tip of the catheter. If you loop the catheter, it will not go through the caudal apparatus. In case if you have a problem that you trapped the cordy, you will get it by significant hypotension of the patient because you will have a mechanical incompetence. If you have a mechanical mitral incompetence, this definitely will be translated into a hemodynamic instability. Even so, if you crossed from the caudal apparatus, but it does not have a lot of traction against the cordy, the length of the balloon, of deployment of the valve, if it, you are lucky enough and the balloon did not travel to the LV, nothing will happen. But never, ever guarantee that it will not happen, because once you inflate the balloon, it can be pushed inside the ventricle. This will tear the cordy. So I advise, if you don't see the catheter is comfortable without hemodynamic problem, without excessive what we call ectopics, your catheter and wire is okay. If you are in doubt, exchange this one into a big tail. The big tail will never transfer to traverse through the caudal apparatus.
Okay. Dr. Hatif Hudwali, you have the mic now. You can ask. Dr. Hatif Hudwali, you can turn on the mic. Unmuted. Okay.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you, Dr. Reda, for his excellent presentation as usual.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hatif.
My question about why is an interventionalist usually prefer CT in the measurement over the echo, in spite of the great progress in 3D echo?
Definitely. I have to say that Dr. Atif, he is one of the excellent echocardiographer and clinical cardiologists, and now he is one of the pioneer transesophageal echocardiographers in our hospital. Dr. Atif, he nowadays in the last maybe 2 years, he is mastering the TomTec and the TEE 3D. Definitely, the 3D TEE is almost matched, and it gives the same results, but it is an operator dependent. So it's only short live images. You do the measurements, you do the calculation. If it was not appropriate, it was not correct measurements, we cannot reproduce it in most of the cases. But for the CT, it is reproducible. So we have a lot of CTs, but we don't have a lot of transesophageal perfect or expert people to do. But if I have an expert one to get a meter and the coronary height, this is all what I need, so I can 100% count on the echo, especially the 3D echo, without going to the CT. And thank you very much for joining us, Dr. Atif.
Thank you, Dr. Reda. Second question, Dr. Reda. In cases of severe aortic regurg, who is high risk for surgery? TAVI can be done?
Yes.
Pure aortic regurg?
Yes. TAVI can be safely done in pure aortic regurgitation in well-selected patients. Remember that we don't 100% need the calcium. The calcium is a good anchor, but it is not all the anchor. The aortic root has its own fibrous skeleton, which is the annulus fibrosus. If we could get the proper measurements, the annulus fibrosus is strong enough to hold the valve. But I have to know very well what is the limitation for each valve and what is the what we call limits I should not push. But in brief, aortic regurgitation with an annulus not more than 27 to 28 is more or less doable with the currently available two valves, because all other valves, they don't have this big size. But it is doable.
Thank you, Dr. Abbott.
My pleasure, Dr. Raff.
Okay, Dr. Atif, thank you. I have a question for you, Dr. Reda, about the CT and transesophageal echo. The choroblamar view in the CT there is something like in the TE can be similar to coronary view of the CT. I mean, if you use a coronary view from the CT, you can add something when you add the work of the during TAVI. So,
Dr. Sharif, can you repeat the question, please?
Sorry. The coronary view from the CT, multi-slice CT.
Yes.
You can show the three cusp in the coronary view. So you can add this in on the to be more simple in the during the TAVI procedures. The TEE can add the same.
No, this is a good question. The CT can give you by different ways the volume rendering, the MIP projection, whatever. There is multiple ways, and even there is a lot of systems that can automatically it can pick it up. So the CT, it's very easy to get the coplanar view because it's a three-dimensional view. But for the TEE, the transesophageal echo cannot split the aorta into two halves because you need to spread the three cusps flatly. This is not the job from the TEE. I don't know exactly, but as the best of my knowledge, I do not expect that the TEE can bring us the coplanar view. The TEE does not give you the proper nadir points in the three points, and you can spread them to have it on the same line. Even there is a software came from Siemens, it can give you all above the nadir, but it does not give you the shape of the sinuses. So the software we presented last time, you can see the aortic root, the annulus, the sinuses, the coronary height, the STJ, but it does not give you the nadir of the leaflets in one line that you can get it as the coplanar.
Okay.
I have one question coming from Mr. Iyad from Edward. He is asking that one data or some data presented that the patient prosthesis mismatch is more or less an overestimated phenomena. I do agree 100%. It is around less than 2 of the current TAVR area. If you have a proper sizing and proper valve selection, either intra-annular or supra-annular, you will not have a patient prosthesis mismatch. The problem will happen only if you have a massively calcified leaflets and you select the small valve and you could not displace these leaflets to the maximal, or you have a bicuspid aortic valve and you wrongly integrated one view as the valve is well opened, while at you look to another view, you see the valve is extremely compressed. The area is the area which is based on three-dimensional AP and lateral or 260-degree away angles that you will see that your prosthesis is well expanded. The real patient prosthesis mismatch when we are dealing with a new annulus, which is the new annulus is the previous sid valve, because now we don't deal with the patient annulus, we are dealing with the valve annulus, which is, it can be a source of patient prosthesis mismatch. In my practice, I had never seen a single patient prosthesis mismatch post-TAVI. So I really agree with your point that it is overestimation, and we discussed before in our, maybe in the third or the fourth webinar, what we call the pressure recovery phenomena, and this is how it can overestimate the gradient and can give you a patient prosthesis mismatch. But if you take the patient to the cath lab and you calculate the hemodynamics, you will not have a patient prosthesis mismatch. And thank you very much for your nice question.
Okay, we have a question from Dr. Ahmed Al-Kirdani, and we are welcome to join us.
Dr. Ahmed Kes is my جراحة القلب في مستشفى عين شمس. Thank you for attending with us, Dr. Ahmed, Chief of Department of Cardiosurgery عين شمس University. You are welcomed.
Dr. Ahmed, you can turn on the mic.
Hello?
Yes, we hear you.
An excellent presentation, very excellent presentation. I want to ask you what prophylaxis against endocarditis in the case of TAVI? I only see only one case in Egypt, but in the literature, the incidence is a little bit higher than, I don't know why.
Okay. First of all, we are very happy that you are with us, Dr. Ahmed. We have to say that the endocarditis is an infection that it happens for the new leaflet, one of the triad of structural degeneration of the leaflets. This is a new category, a new definitions, a new a lot of data is coming. Infective endocarditis can happen due to bacteremia or septicemia or whatever, with an area of turbulence, especially if we have a significant aortic incompetence, especially of the paravalvular leak. So I have a combination of a bacteremia or septicemia plus turbulence across the valve. So this is the media needed for the infective endocarditis. There is another route for the infective endocarditis is platelet incorporation. Inadequate anticoagulation will start the platelet incorporation into the leaflets, so the leaflets will start to be a better media or a good media for to have easier to take any sort of bacteremia or easy to have an infective endocarditis inoculation to these new leaflets. So according to the guidelines, all patients with any implant, either ASD, VSD, PDA, coarctation, TAVI, we should have a prophylaxis infective endocarditis for the first 6 months, unless if we have any hemodynamic problem. Say, for example, we have a good TAVI, we don't have any problem, there is no gradient, there is no paravalvular leak, infective endocarditis prophylaxis is only 6 months. If I have a significant paravalvular leak or a significant gradient across the valve, so this patient is categorized as high risk, so he has to use the regular protocol for broad spectrum antibiotics prophylaxis, all infective endocarditis for life. If he still he has the same, you have to treat them as exactly as the native valvular problem or endocarditis for the mechanical or dysfunctioning bioprosthetic valves. But this is a very important topic, actually. I had to compromise to present the structural deterioration of the valves today instead of one case. So I hope that because this is an important topic, I will present it with the complication next week, inshallah.
Okay, thank you. Excellent presentation.
My pleasure, Dr. Ahmed. Thank you very much for joining us.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Ahmed Kardani. Dr. Mohammed Abdel Majid. Yes.
Assalamu alaikum, Effendi.
Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Excellent presentation and the three difficult and excellent case scenarios. I have three. One belongs to Edwards valve. Why it foreshortens from the inflow side, and why the foreshortening or the shortening is more in the newer generation? Is this something intentional or not? This is my first question.
Okay, so to me, it's the new design. The company, they wanted to keep the level of what we call when you start to deploy the valve, your upper eyes to the upper level of the valve, and you wanted to get this the shortest as much as you can from the LV side. So when the Edward valve started to be in place, the people started to have the valve 50-50, 50 up and 50 down. With 50-50, if you don't have an enough good anchor, you might have an apical displacement or an apical migration of the valve. But if you decrease the LV portion of the valve, the probability to have an apical migration of the valve is less. So nowadays, we are doing our valves 80 to 90% aortic and 10 to 20 maximum in the LV. This will decrease the trauma to the membranous septum, decrease the incidence of heart block, decrease the possibility of migration because the valve will be a little bit flared from up. And as we discussed last time, that the leading forces for valve migration is from the aorta to the LV. Not from the LV to the aorta, because when the ventricle contracts, it contracts against open leaflets, so it does not have any resistance. But when the aortic closure forces comes, it comes against the closed leaflets, so it takes the whole circumference. So the backward push and forces from the aorta to the LV is much, much, much higher. So if the valve is not well anchored up, and most of the valve is up, you will have this probability of valve migration and the heart block. The design, how they did it, because I think they did it because of the different design of the four level of the of the cells. It's big one, and the angle is narrow between the edge of the cells, so the what we call the degree of expansion does not come on the expense of shortening. So it's a design, it's a genius design from my point of view, and it gave much, much better. And when we are used for the Sabian 3, for me it's very difficult to use the Sabian XT, because this is the real what we call precise positioning of the valve as you wanted to put it.
Second question is related to the bicuspid aortic valve. First, regarding the implantation level of TAVI in bicuspid valve, we do it at a higher level, so it's more close to the coronaries. In addition to that, in bicuspid aortic valve, the leaflet height is usually is higher because the leaflet size is bigger, so the possibility of coronary occlusion is high. Can we do basilica in native bicuspid valve or only in tissue valves?
Another excellent question. Yes, sometimes in patients with low coronary implantation, especially in bicuspid valves, if you have a risk of coronary occlusion, basilica had been done and can be done in the native leaflets, and even it is as easy as the bioprosthetic. So it's the best way to avoid what we call acute coronary obstruction on cyto, but still this patient will have the risk from the TAVI in TAVI if he survived for the second TAVI, because he might be in need for a second basilica to the newly implanted valve. But yes, the basilica can be done to the native leaflets.
Third question is related to valve, so it's relation to the coronaries. The surgeons usually put their valve at the level of ventricular arterial junction, the surgical annulus, which is close to the coronaries. What is in the CT, what is the lower limit of height between the surgical annulus and the coronaries that is allowed to do TAVI?
I need to correct for you one information that the surgeons, their valving, it is one of two mechanisms. Either it is a supra-annular or intra-annular. The commonest is intra-annular. Sometimes if they have a problem with what we call the valve, that they need to put it in a higher position. If you look carefully to this view, this is the C-wing ring. Either to put it exactly by this way, this is the ventricular arterial junction, which is the anatomical annulus. Usually the C-wing ring is here. What is near to the coronary in the skeleton or the struts of the humps, the three humps of the valve itself. And this is the one is related to the coronaries, but not the C-wing ring. If you wanted to assess it, usually we assess it through the CT. In the CT, we will see what is the what we call this view. It's summarizing the relation of the bioprosthetic valves to the coronaries. Most of the scenarios is similar to this one. If you have a coronary height more than 13 millimeter, most of the bioprosthetic valve, they are between 13 to 16 millimeter according to the size. So if you have a big sinuses and the coronary height is almost at the level of the upper part of the valve and the sinuses are big, you don't have a risk of coronary artery compromise during the valve in valve. The problem comes when you have this what we call effaced or very narrow sinus and low coronaries. If you displace the leaflets out or if you fracture the valve to expand it out, you cannot guarantee even basilica alone might not be enough to protect the coronaries. And again, if you have another bad category, which is that the valve, which is very, very unlikely, the valve is above the STJ, because usually the sinotubular junction is more than 15 millimeter out of these valves that it will go up to this level. And usually the sinotubular junction is between 120 to 150 large percent larger than the annulus. So you don't expect to have it closed like this. Usually it is bigger than the annulus. So the assessment of the patient will come from the CT. The CT is crucial. We have to see the ring of the valve. We have to see what we call valve to coronary VTC distance. This one is the most important to detect if you have any risk of coronary occlusion or any possibility to compromise the coronary flow. And there is one digit, it's 4 millimeter. If you are less than 4 millimeter, don't try to do it without protection to the coronaries or without finding a solution to the coronaries. This is for the right, this is for the non-coronary, this is what we call VTC. So it's the skeleton of the valve. Thank you very much, Dr.
Mohammed. Dr. Ahmed Al-Qaddami, and then we will ask Dr. Ahmed Kamil. Dr. Ahmed Al-Qaddami. Okay. Dr. Ahmed.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam, my brother, Dr. Ahmed.
Thank you very much, Dr. Reda, for this very informative, illustrative talk. I really enjoyed. I know you are so tired now. I hope not. My question is, thank you, alhamdulillah. My question is really very simple. If a patient is high risk for surgery, is there any circumstances or any situation that you can say there is no chance for TAVI or TAVI can be done under any circumstances? Thank you.
This is very big question. The question is percutaneous valves can be done for every patient or not? Definitely, you cannot say yes, because I can get you next time one patient, which is a clear example that how can that the leaflet thickness and the coronary height and the narrow sinotubular junction will never allow you to put a valve without removing the leaflets. So this is as simple as that. So the difficulty or the impossibility of the TAVI related to access, but we have a lot of alternative, starting from the apex, ending to the transcaval, carotid, axillary, subclavian, femoral, you have a lot of access. So the access problem is usually does not prohibit the surgery, even finally the transaortic. The other option or the other problem is when you have a small annulus, say for example, annulus which is 16 millimeter. If the annulus is truly, you cannot by any means put an Edward valve. But you might have a chance to put a self-expandable valve. But usually, these patients, when they have a very, very small annulus, the sinotubular junction will be the sinus of Valsalva will be very narrow, and you expect that the coronary will be low because this is a syndromatic aorta, that you have a very small annulus. It will be a small ascending aorta, low coronaries, and this will not be ideal. So if the TAVI is applicable for everyone, I can say no, it should be case by case. But there is one between brackets that there is an entity of patients we can push the limits. This is the limitation of the TAVI, but if you have expertise, they can put push the limits safely, they can do some extra more cases. And the best application for this is the bicuspid valves. When the TAVI starts, the bicuspid valve was totally prohibited from the TAVI, and then step by step, the people started to push the limits, and now the bicuspid valve with the all the meta-analysis and with the registries, they are doing very well.
Thank you
very much, Ahmed.
Dr. Ahmed Kamel, you have the mic now, and you can ask.
Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Rada. Urgent lecture as usual.
Thank you.
I have two questions. The first one is about if a patient came with no previous data, with no data available about previous implanted prosthesis, and he needs valve-in-valve procedure. How to know the previous data in other than fluoro?
This is a good question. Again, this has come to Dr. Atif, that when you have the TEE, you will be able to get the true diameter of the valve. This is very good. If you have the patient cannot go for contrasted CT, the dry CT will give you a very clear image of the true diameter of the valve. It's the inner diameter. It's not the true diameter, because the true diameter is the inner minus the thickness of the leaflets. So the CT or the echo will give you the image. The type of the valve, you will get it from the X-ray, because the X-ray, most of the valves, they have their own footprints, except for the Sanjud. The Sanjud, you don't see anything. But when you don't see anything, this is an EBIC valve or BioCore valve, which from Sanjud. This is a group of patients. Another group of patients, they do not have any radiolucent, which is the stentless, the homograph, the freestyle, or the Toronto. All these valves, you do not see anything. So it is exactly at the native aorta. They don't have any specific criteria. So the echo also will give you the same measurements. So it will be okay. Here, the echo, even as equal as the CT, but the CT will give you for the stented valves more data.
Okay, thanks, Dr. Arda. Please, another question. If we have a RFA, does it differ that the RFA is between the left or right coronary cusp, or between the right or none? I mean, which, the RFA change its position. Does this have any implication in our work?
Definitely no. But usually when you have RFA, it means that this bulk of leaflet is a big one. It is against the two coronaries in the same time. But it is not my choice. This is an incident that it should be away from this one, because the two leaflets that were conjoined together with this RFA, left and right, it means that the left and right coronary are coming against this big leaflet, with the possibility to compromise the two coronaries if we have something wrong on the same time. But if I choose, I prefer to be away from that. Instance-wise, it is by this way. If we have patients with two RFE type, this is what we call the single, what we call the unicuspid aortic valve. And this unicuspid aortic valve, they are less in number, but they are more difficult, more complication, because this type of leaflets does not split very well, and usually the valve does not expand very well.
Much thanks, Dr. Reda, for the informative answer.
Thank you very much, Ahmed.
We have the last question, Dr. Mohammed. You open your mic if you want to ask your question by yourself. Okay, his question is about the TAVI valve. Some school prefer to put diving and wire with the stent ready, and once deploy your valve, you inflate both stents, left main RCA. Are you agree with this school or not?
Again, this is...
Kindly explain the question.
I will. Dr. Mohammadi is asking a very important question. In cases when you have a high risk of coronary artery occlusion, the coronary artery occlusion issue is the most critical and the most important preoperative assessment, because it cannot be solved in a lot of situations, if not all the situations, if you totally occlude the coronary with the valve deployment. So it is a point of prevention. How to prevent? First, to categorize your patient at a risk of coronary occlusion. Say, for example, we have a patient with mitral flow bioprosthetic valve, size 19 or 21. The height of this valve is 14 to 15 millimeter. If it is high in the annulus, definitely it is against the coronary. This type of valves, the leaflets are, so when you push the valve, you push the skeleton and you are more pushing the leaflets toward the coronaries. So if you do not calculate the risk beforehand, the coronary occlusion will be inevitable and it will be fatal. This is number one. Number two, if you have the patient is at extreme high risk or at high risk, one of the safest way is to put a guide catheter inside the targeted risk for coronary. So you put the guide catheter inside, but if you have the guide catheter inside and you don't have a wire and you don't have a stent in, you might not be able on time to push everything there. Especially when you have the guide alone, the valve deployment will displace the guide away. But when you have the guide with wire and stent in place inside the coronaries, and you see that there is a probability of coronary occlusion, you just take the stent out to the target position and inflate it. So it is a safe way to what we call protect the coronary. Another way, we call it chimney. The chimney, when you have a patient with a very narrow sinuses, with extremely high risk for coronary occlusion, you put the stent from the very beginning in the guide catheter and you take it long way away from the bioprosthesis. You do not have 1 to 2 millimeter protrusion. You might have 5+ millimeter protrusion. But remember, the left main or the coronary occlusion with pathology is different than mechanical compression. The long term of these stents till now is unknown. So first, if you have the patient with a high risk for coronary occlusion, you have to find another alternative way, because the surgeons, they do not have this risk. So the patient is left away. You have to calculate properly the risk. And patients with extreme high risk for coronary occlusion, please don't do them except if you have a circulatory support ready in place, because this is the only way it can give you time to work. If you have a coronary occlusion and you have a problem with deploying the stent and the coronary was occluded, if you don't have a circulatory support, you will not salvage this patient. Thank you very much for this nice question.
Dr. Mohammed, you have another question? Yes. You can talk. We hear you. Dr. Mohammed.
اوكي السلام عليكم. انا طبعا بحيي دكتور رضا, ربنا يجازيك كل خير. وانا بس يعني جاست ان انا بشكر حضرتك وبشكر المجموعه كلها على اتاحه الفرصه, وربنا يجازيك كل خير وينفع بعلمك يا رب.
Thank you very much دكتور محمد, it's my pleasure to share us this scientific meeting. Thank you very much.
Okay, you are the final about the next meeting, so this is can everyone vote for this question?
The idea of this one is I'm planning next time to be TAVI complication and management, and this one would be the last one in the TAVI series, or we need more cases presentation, different scenarios, or we need to cover some missing basic information that everyone can share us to say that we need to do this one. Or we can do a workshop for how to do the CT for TAVI, to do it by ourselves if we can. This is another one, or we can make it in a separate entity. But my point is, next time we will go for the complication to try to wrap up all the missing data, because usually the complication is the most important session when you would like to cover a topic to the end. This is important one. So according to your voting,
we have want others to vote. We have.
Yes, the best scenario will be according to the vote. And thank you for everyone for the poll. دكتور رضا بارك الله فيك وربنا يجعلها في ميزان حسناتك اللي بتنشره في العلم, ربنا يبارك فيك طول عمرك يعني.
Thank you
for everyone attending. ربنا يعني طول عمرك أخ وصديق ومعلم للجميع.
Thank you very much.
Thank you دكتور شريف for the لو حنسميها logistics and the audio visual. Thank you everyone attending from Egypt and outside Egypt. I leave the mic for you, Sharif and Dr. Reda, please.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed. Thank you very much for your effort and for your support. And I hope that I will add anything, whatever everyone will ask. I'm very happy to do it, inshallah.
Okay. I will send the link.
But this is a very little number. This is only it's 10 persons. But it's okay. I will respect the vote. So the next time will be the TAVI complication and management, and it would be the last one for the TAVI. But if anyone he has any question,
if Hassan Hashmat can, he said he won't CT workshop.
My pleasure. Yes. If Hussein is happy for that, we can arrange another session between who is interested. Just do the logistics and we will sit down to do it. Maybe it's a 2 hour session, or yani multiple sessions, each one will be 1 hour, and I'm very very happy to do it with Dr. Hussein. He's my my beloved brother for sure.
Okay, we are now
So now the next time will be in the same time, inshallah. We will have a TAVI complication and management next week, inshallah.
Okay. Thank you Dr. Ahmed Tamara. Thank you everyone.
Thank you very much for everyone.
Okay.